comes, and the speaker is Sri Damodar Prasad, retired senior AFA in South Central Railway. A brief introduction of Sri Damodar Prasad. Sri Damodar Prasad joined the Railway Accounts Department in the year 1979 and entered supervisory cadre in 1986. He has passed all the three groups of the Appendix 3A examination and has worked in all the as accounts in all the three wings of the account supervisory cadre. He has varied experience in general accounts, workshop accounts, construction accounts, and divisional accounts. Sri Damodar Prasad entered the gazetted cadre in the year 2000, and he has worked in South Central Railway headquarters in pension, budget, finance establishment, draft paras, general inspection, and expenditure section. Sri Damodar Prasad has a passion for teaching railway accounts to 2A and 3A aspirants, and he has been a visiting faculty at Sitara and ZRTI and other training institutes in South Central Railway, and also the National Academy of Indian Railways at Vadodara. Presently, Mr. Damodar Prasad is a visiting faculty at IRDIM. Thank you. Over to Sri Damodar Prasad.
Good morning to all of you.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning, sir.
Very good morning. Please unmute so that.
Good morning, sir.
Yeah, please unmute your mics so that there will not be any disturbance to others.
May I mute all of the participants?
Yes, please.
At the end of session, I will unmute for interaction and doubt clarification.
Thank you. Yeah.
Sir, please unmute, sir, your audio.
Sir, please unmute your audio.
So, dear participants.
Yes, sir. Now we are getting. Please.
Welcome to this webinar on appropriation accounts. This is one of the important functions, and we can call it as the constitutional function also, as part of budgetary process. In the 7th chapter of Accounts Department, which narrates about the annual accounts and returns to be submitted, a few are given in Chapter 7 of Accounts Department, Accounts Code. They are: one, after closure of the finance accounts for the year, we require to submit capital and revenue accounts which suit to the commercial accounting practices. We also prepare finance accounts which suit to the government accounting system. Other than these two, we also prepare a debt report on the balances of suspense heads. This also is part of our annual accounts and returns. And last but not the least, these appropriation accounts. First three, that is capital and revenue accounts, finance accounts, and debt head report, these are dealt in Accounts Code Volume 1, whereas the appropriation accounts has been dealt
recording in progress
in Chapter 4 of Finance Code. What is that we are going to achieve by these appropriation accounts? As I said, it is a constitutional function which we will be discussing in detail. Actually, financial accountability and budgetary practices, these are scrutinized through appropriation accounts. How the financial accountability is ensured and budgetary practices, whether good budgetary practices are being followed, these are scrutinized through appropriation accounts. Let me introduce about this appropriation accounts. Parliamentary financial control is secured, we knew that it is through submission of our demands in the form of demand for grants, requirement of funds to the parliament. So it is secured not only by the fact that expenditure must receive the approval from parliament, but also the system of reporting back to parliament. Comparing the actual expenditure incurred vis-a-vis the grants as voted by parliament or sanctioned by president. This will be done by scrutiny of CNAG, Comptroller and Auditor General of India, and the Public Accounts Committee. So the appropriation accounts, they are not scrutinized at larger parliament sessions, but through Public Accounts Committee, the scrutiny will be done because the budgetary process has already been dealt by both the houses of parliament. The second purpose is to get the excess expenditure incurred in any financial year regularized from the parliament through submission of appropriation accounts. Unless this excess, if any, is certified by CNAG, the grant cannot be regularized. We knew that any grant, it requires vote of parliament when we take from Consolidated Fund of India. But when we incur certain expenditure more than grant, normally it should not happen, but suppose it happens, then in such a case, how it gets regularized? It is by means of submission of appropriation accounts through Public Accounts Committee and scrutiny of this Comptroller and Auditor General of India. So when actual expenditure incurred exceeds approved grants of the Parliament, Ministry of Finance presents these demands for excess grant. The excess grant means to cover the excess over the grant already approved, if any incurred. This will be presented, and this demand for the excess grant is made after actual expenditure is incurred. It is not during the financial year. It will not be done after closure of the financial year and at the time of scrutiny, after scrutiny of the appropriation accounts by CNAG and the recommendation of PAC, then the demand for excess grant is made to the parliament, in which the financial year in which the excess was incurred. If no excess, absolutely no need. So this CNAG brings such excesses to the notice of parliament through appropriation accounts. So on railways, allotting one single demand, we all knew that one single demand, 82, 83 or 84, single demand is allotted in place of earlier 16 demands. So this has brought down the need for seeking excess grant and witnessed a number of cases of reduction in Annexure J misclassification items also. So the appropriation accounts are the statements which compares the amount of actual expenditure with the amount of grants as voted by parliament and appropriation sanctioned by president. So the grant vis-a-vis the actual expenditure incurred. So actual expenditure incurred normally we'll be taking from our final account current, and the grants as voted by parliament will be taking from book of demands. The appropriation accounts, these are prepared after closure of financial year and after sending the final account current for March. A detailed program, normally it is issued by Railway Board in consultation with CNDG. The for 2020-21 already the instructions for detailed program has been issued by Railway Board, and it is available in our railway website also. You may go through that so that you will have a more clear picture about these appropriation accounts, how they are to be prepared and what they are prepared. So this detailed, when advance copy has to be submitted to our associate audit, and when certified copy need to be furnished to headquarters as well as from headquarters to Railway Board, and from PDA to Asian CNDG, apex body available in Railway Board who will oversee on behalf of CNDG. For him also, from PDA it will go that what are all the certificates he has given. So this is the detailed program. It will be issued by Railway Board in consultation with CNDG, because the audit department also, they have to cooperate and complete this program because the appropriation accounts, whatever they are being scrutinized, they should be, suppose 2020-21, they have to be submitted to Parliament in the winter session of the year in which to which they pertain. So 21 in winter session, they have to be presented to the Parliament. So the program, whatever it is given by Railway Board, it should be adhered to. And all of us, we should treat it as a constitutional function. And whatever details are, whatever, suppose some remarks have to be given, those additional remarks have to be given immediately, or even orally, or even going and giving discussing at appropriate level. And this is the process which we have to. And similarly, when Railway Board asks certain information, in such cases also, immediately we have to comply with. The ultimate goal is that the target dates which are given for submission of advance copy to an audit and certified copy to be sent to Railway Board. So these are the things to be kept, and a nodal officer at headquarters also will be nominated to oversee that these are being submitted or not. Normally, Deputy CEO books and budget, normally he will be the nodal officer in headquarters, and he will be in, consulted by Railway Board also. So this is how the monitoring will be done. Actually, you may be surprised how many statements or how many accounts which we have to submit under appropriation accounts. Normally, it comprises of 44 statements. If we make certain analysis, we can observe that the statements which are related to our grants or which are related to our abstracts, they are around 16. So 14 revenue abstracts, one for work and one for civil grant. So total 16 statements are related to grants. So how these appropriation accounts related to grants are to be submitted, because the Railway Board budget has been after merger of Railway budget with general budget. Now we are not having 16 demands, only one demand is given. So how it will be done, this is the major change that has happened. So that also we will discuss. So we should know that out of 44 statements, 16 statements are related to grants. Then another 10 statements
Sir,
Damodar
sir, please unmute.
Okay.
Okay, sir.
So it comprises of all 44 statements. 44 statements, I said. Then 16 are related to grants that we will discuss in detail, and 10 annexures A to J and annexure B, part 1 review, otherwise known as annexure K, defects in budgeting, excluding annexure G. These are 10 annexures. We will discuss about them in detail also. And apart from that, the third part of appropriation accounts is accounts and statements. As a part of appropriation accounts, 15 accounts and statements, they have to be prepared. And recently, one edition, earlier it used to be 14, and now 15, one edition has been done. It is statement of plan headwise, including suspense heads, because inventory suspense heads are there. So for them also, source-wise and work expenditure, voted and charged. Gross credit net in units of rupees, we have to prepare. So this is the new statement which was added. So 15 accounts and statements. Then annexure G, I said in under annexures, annexure G, I excluded. So that annexure G, it is related to finance accounts, and they constitute three statements. One statement is block account, another statement is balance sheet, and third statement is P&L account. So 3 plus 15 plus 10 plus 16, all together 44 statements. For each of these 44 statements, the Railway Board detailed program, it will indicate advance copy when to be submitted and certified copy when to be submitted. And a nodal officer is nominated from each railway, and the respective PDAs, they have to submit their certificates to the concerned additional CNDG who will be working on behalf of CNDG as far as railways are concerned. Then these appropriation accounts at Railway Board level, at journal level, it will be signed by PFA and GM in person. And the appropriation accounts at Railway Board level, consolidated, we call them as consolidated appropriation accounts. They will be submitted, signed by CRB and CEO and member finance in the capacities of, say, ex officio principal secretary to Government of India and ex officio secretary to Government of India. Then, how these appropriation accounts are prepared, in what form they are prepared, and what are the columns which we have, and as far as grants are concerned, now I will be discussing about the grants, 16 grants, and in that revenue segment and capital segment also will be there. As far as works matters, that is capital segment, is concerned, the format is same, but some or few additions are there. That also we will know in due course. So this appropriation accounts, they are prepared in form 403, F403, for gross, for each of the grant or abstract. And the credits, whatever they are there, for under each grant, it will be shown as a separate note, then footnote. Apart from why gross, because we knew that the budget, when we prepared for budget demands for grants, we seek sanction from president or vote of parliament for gross expenditure. So therefore, the appropriation accounts also, they have to be prepared on gross basis. And in that, the column, inner column, will have to show original grant, supplementary grant, and residual grant. These are indicated separately in column 1. So original grant means originally what the grant was communicated as a budget grant, and supplementary grant is when certain excess expenditure, when excess requirements were put forth by railways, and we may have to, if reappropriations are not possible, we may have to go to parliament, and in such cases, if supplementary grant has been obtained, it will be separately communicated to railways. So this supplementary grant, again, the demand, the subhead, and the primary unit where we asked and where the grant was given, it will be shown and added to the original grant separately. It will not be included as a original grant. This is supplementary grant. Then the residual grant is the difference between final grant and O plus S. That will be the residual grant. So this also, it will be indicated in the column 1. And column 2, final grant, whatever communicated in the month of March, that will be shown. And column 3 is the actual expenditure. Actual expenditure as reflected in our account current, final account current. And column 4, it is variation between either excess or saving. If it is excess, plus figure, and saving, negative figure. That is column 3 from actual expenditure. Final grant will be minused, and then excess or saving, it will be indicated. However, the explanation, whatever, suppose abstract 03 if you take, then 100, 200, 300, we knew the minor heads. So minor head wise, we have to give the variation between actual expenditure and total grant. Please listen here this carefully. Here I am telling that excess or saving, it will be indicated, the difference between actual expenditure and final grant. In the column 4, it will be shown. But the explanation, while giving the explanation, we have to give minor headwise, but there the variation expenditure will be, variation should be explained between actual expenditure and total grant. That is total grant. Whenever I use the word total grant, it is O plus S. In the column 1, whatever we have shown, original grant and supplementary grant and actual expenditure, the difference between these two, it has to be shown minor headwise and explained subheadwise. Please remember this carefully, and in the coming slides, I will show the pro forma also. Okay, then all excesses or savings exceeding 500 lakhs. This is the limit which was changed in the recent on 7th May for the year 2020-21 appropriation accounts. The letter was given. So please be careful about these limits. So they will be changing from year to year. So the excess or saving in excess of 500 lakhs, or excess or saving exceeding 10% of the provision, or 250 lakhs, whichever is higher. And in case of supplementary grants, where saving exceeds 10% of supplementary grant or 100 lakhs, whichever is higher, they should be explained. That means whenever defects in budgeting is prepared by our audit team, if the excesses fall under these, we can request them to drop such items if any by mistake they have added. So what are all the things that we have to keep in mind for excesses is the, because for the excesses over these limits, we have to give explanation. So before below that, we need not give. So therefore, any, and that will not constitute defects in budgeting. And if any by mistake it was added, then we can argue with them at appropriate level. So all cases of excess or saving exceeding 500 lakhs, where excess or saving exceeding 10% of the provision or 250 lakhs, whichever is higher. And in case of supplementary grant, where saving exceeds 10% of supplementary grant or 100 lakhs, whichever is higher, they should be explained. So this is all about revenue. Now come to the capital segment. So capital segment, they will be compiled in four parts. Four parts will be there. So part one is capital, all capital works. That is source-wise we will go. So capital, and under capital, plan heads. So what are all the plan heads? So 1100, 1400, 1500, 1600, likewise. So capital, then after that, railway funds. So DRF, DFCF, and safety fund, railway safety fund, those two plan heads, 29 and 30. And RRSK, what are the plan heads and works? So these plan head wise will be giving. But please remember here, now under revenue, these are the limits for which we need to explain. But in plan heads or works expenditure, explanation shall be work-wise. So if it is a work-wise, then there will be lot many works will be there. So how to go about? So the standing and the public accounts committee and the 17th Lok Sabha, they have recommended that only for those works falling under the criteria, they have to be explained. Not all works, not all planets. So only those which are falling under criteria, they have to be explained. And for revenue as well as capital, both charged and voted. Normally under revenue grants, will be first voted and then charged. Likewise, we'll be giving. And here also, under capital source, each plan head, wherever charged is there, we will also indicate for charged and voted separately. Now, come to the criteria for works. So, when coming to the criteria for works, this is most important because one, we should know that the reason for the variation explained with reference to the O plus S, that is original grant plus supplementary grant and actual expenditure. Actual expenditure minus these two, whatever it is coming. So, under, for all works which are there for plan heads, 1100, gauge conversion 1400, doubling 1500, electrification projects 3500, we have to explain for all works. There is no limit here. Now, you see here, for works costing more than 20 crore, for works costing more than 20 crore under plan heads, track renewals 3100, 3200 bridge works, and 3300 plant, S&T, we need to have the explanation. Okay, the reasons for variation of works falling under the there are certain guidelines or given criteria. So for them only we have to give explanation. For suppose under 1100 there will be so many works will be there, but suppose 100 works are there. For 100 works we need not do, but under that, if any work falling under the criteria which I am going to tell, only for them we need to explain. We need to explain, the explanation has to be given. Now listen to this very carefully, because this is the criteria which we have to follow. So new lines, gauge conversion, doubling, railway electrification, and what's costing more than 20 crores under plan head 31, 32, 3300. For the works which are falling under the criteria, we need not explain. And above this criteria, if any variation is there, then we need to explain. Now let us go to the criteria, most important one. The entire supplementary grant remains unutilized in any of these plan heads, in any of these works. If you have asked, say, 10 crores of supplementary grant, and entire 10 crores remain unutilized, that is, your savings are more than 10 crores, then we need to explain. That means why we asked more grant and why we are not able to spend, we have to explain. Then another criteria is entire O plus S grant remain unutilized. That means we asked originally and we also asked supplementary, and eventually at the end of the year we could not utilize. Naturally, the PAC and Controller Auditor General, they would like to know the reasons. So that is why we have to explain in this case also. Suppose any work supplementary grant, we asked 100 crores. Okay, in that 10% of that supplementary grant, that is 10 crores, or 100 lakhs, whichever is higher, remain unutilized, we have to explain. Then one more thing is where the variation, that is excess, whenever we knew that variation means excess or saving. So whenever variation or excess exceeds 500 lakhs over O plus S, we have to explain. This already I made it very clear, and same limits were laid for works grant also. Then saving or excess exceeding 250 lakhs or 10% of O plus S, but did not exceed 500 lakhs, this also we need to explain in any work of these plan heads. If it is saving or excess beyond this 250 lakhs or 10% of the O plus S grant, and but it did not exceed 500 lakhs, then that also needs explanation. So this is how the explanation for the revenue as well as the capital segment need to be explained. We also knew that explanation need to be given wherever is common reason is there. At initially where it is appearing, there we can give the explanation in detail, and wherever other places same we need not repeat. Please give reference to that where you have explained, and it will end. So we need not worry much about that. Similarly, in case where you wanted some debits you are expected from some workshop or from some other railway and you could not get, and finally savings for this, then in that case also you have to explain that from whom you thought that you will be getting but you didn't get. So those remarks you have to give. Similarly, suppose you on revenue side or in capital side, excess over the grant you have spent. So you should explain why that excess is not avoidable, why it cannot be taken in some other in the next financial year, why it could not be, why it could not be postponed, why it has to be paid in this year only, exceeding the grant. So this needs to be explained, because we knew that excess grant has to be regularized by Parliament. We do not have any powers. Those powers are not there with us. So therefore, that explanation, small variations also, if explanation is given by Zonal Railway, and if they are consolidated, and if it is becoming a big amount, then Railway Board will be in a position to explain very effectively to the Parliament, to the PSC or even CNDG also. Then, so I was making a mention that there is because of railway budget merging with general budget, the important change that has happened is only one grant we are having. So in any that means previous 16 grants, wherever excess is there, we used to have a problem with the members of Parliament or Standing Committee. They used to have a scathing attack on railways. But now, because it is a single demand, so all the grants put together, that is each is under major head, sub-major head. Sub-major head means our revenue abstracts, and then capital major head and civil grants. Everything it will be merged, and one single grant only it will be done. And if all the grants put together and all expenditure they take, and if any excess is there, then only we will be going for regularization. So that is the advantage which we got. So this already told. Yeah, this also I told. Gross credit, okay, this also I told. And one more important point is, whenever the appropriation accounts after submission by due date, sometimes we may, or Railway Board may ask us to open our books. So by that time, we may have submitted and got signature from GM or PFA and or from our PDA also, but certification also we may have received. So in such case, again, for that particular portion, you need to open and issue a correction. In seriatim, you have to give, and as shown, already certified, and what should be shown should be very clearly mentioned, and simultaneously, we have to send it to board and audit, and audit and board we have to submit. And these correction slips should be submitted at the signature of J-grade officer, not less than J-grade officer, and all the correction slips serially numbered at the end of the financial, at the end of the appropriation accounts certification, we need to apprise to general manager, as well as we need not obtain approval per se, but these are the correction slips issued. We have to bifurcate them into at the instance of audit, and on our own we have rectified. So suppose 50 correction slips are issued. The broad category we have to make, and then for information we have to give to PFA and general manager, because we got the signature from them. So then this note, invariably audit will ask, and we have to furnish a copy of that. That means we have brought letter corrections brought to the notice of PFA and the general manager, who are the signatories for this. Okay, then so this is the format in which the revenue segment, now after merger of railway budget with general budget, so this is the format which we have to give. And say the columns, they are not changed. This is minor head or major head, total grant or appropriation, other is and actual expenditure, and variation, saving or excess. So for here it is major head, it was mentioned 3001 because it is railway board, and 3002 for us, and then sub major head also we have to show. So charged expenditure, first explained, original, supplementary, I was making a mention. And this is total grant, is this final grant, whatever it is there. So the reason, suppose saving is there. So saving is or the so and so is incurred due to so and so. So that kind of explanation we have to give, and the figures should be in thousands of rupees. Barring in almost all grants, it should be thousands of rupees. So this first will be for the abstract, it will be shown like this. Then further bifurcation, we'll be giving say 3002, 3003, general superintendence. So under general superintendence, 01 is general superintendence, that is abstract 3. So original grant, supplementary grant, residual grant we'll be giving. But here this is overall 03. And then in we knew that under 03, under 03, we got 03, we got minor head. I said minor head wise we have to give explain the things, minor head wise. So minor head 100, so O plus S R, again this will be there, and this minor head variation should be explained sub head wise. I said sub head wise, excess or saving, whatever it is there, net figure, that should tally with the net variation which we are showing under 100. So 110, 120, 130, whatever excess is there. So for this explanation, we will be mostly relying on the computer center, where it gives the demand as a whole, demand bifurcated into subheads, and expenditure and the difference between these two, so that our reasoning, our explanation should be supported by this kind of documentation. So this is how the explanation will be given. Then capital segment. Capital segment, more or less I said the format is one and the same, but only thing is it will be part 1, part 2, part 3, part 4, four parts. So first part is capital. So capital outlay. So in that, charge expenditure, O plus S, and voted charge. So overall it will be given like this, and further details will be plan head wise. I said capital and plan head. So under plan head, new lines, so say 1100. So in the 1100, O plus S plus R and all the things also we will enter. But for giving the explanation, so whatever difference is there, that difference should be supported by the details of the work. So those details of the work, here the format is changed. Railway, okay, pick book number, one name of the work, original grant, supplementary grant, actual expenditure, net saving, reason for the variation. So whether estimate was not sanctioned, or estimate was sanctioned, prepared, but it is pending, or contract was given, contractor not progressing well, so contract not yet given. So these are all the things which they will be normally explaining and we will be ensuring that these remarks are acceptable to us. So then after 1100, suppose in here charged expenditure is there. So charged we have to give and voted also we have to give. Similarly, next we will go to gauge conversion. So this is how the capital segment also it will be given. And similarly, civil grants also, civil grants for HBA and PC advances, we have to give that explanation. Okay, now the figures, whatever we will be showing, it will be should agree with the annual accounts or final account current, because final account current one copy anyhow we will be giving to the C&D or audit people. So there should not be any variation. Suppose some mistake is there and we should not change that from that head to correct head. As booked in final account current, we have to show them and we need to explain why this could not be rectified. So we have to explain that way. Then in capital segment, the actual expenditure should tally with annexure A of the final account current. You all knew that for final account current, annexure A will be sending. So whatever actual expenditure we are indicating here, it should tally with annexure A of the final account current. Then expenditure actually recorded, this already covered. So after doing this, then let us go into once we complete the appropriation accounts related to grants, once we complete, then let us see the annexures. Annexures, that is already I mentioned that there are some 10 annexures. Annexure A is expenditure held under objection. Annexure B, under charges detected. Annexure C, remission or abandonment of claims. Annexure D, expenditure on open land works and new construction. Of course, this is very, very tedious annexure. I'll let you know actually why it is tedious. Then annexure E, revenue and capital expenditure of strategic lines. So where that means where strategic lines are there. So there they have to give separately annexure E. All other railways they give normally nil. Then annexure F, estimated and actual credits or recoveries. I already mentioned that credits or recoveries, no explanation need be given. But however, we have to show how much we have estimated and how much actually we have received or recovered. Okay, this is annexure F. Then annexure H, losses. So whatever losses are there, those losses which were booked to the final heads. So those losses have to be given here under annexure H. Then irregular reappropriation. We all knew that the reappropriation is the important tool in the hands of the executive for better management of the budget. And if the no doubt the reappropriations are done with the finance concurrence, but in case if any irregular reappropriation is there, then they will be pointed out. Normally we will be 100% accurate, so therefore annexure I will be normally nil. Then annexure J, misclassification and mistakes detected. As I had already mentioned, because of the merger of our railway budget, one boon for the accounts department is that the annexure J items have become very, very less. And what are the items that form annexure J? I'll let you know. Then annexure B part one. So here you see, here annexure B, here also annexure B is there. But all these annexures will be under part two of the appropriation, consolidated appropriation accounts submitted to parliament. So this annexure B, by this name itself, you will understand that it will be available in part one review. Part one review. So under part one review, that means under part one of the appropriation accounts, consolidated appropriation accounts, under review section, you will be having another annexure B. That annexure B, popularly, as I already mentioned, it is known as annexure K. Annexure K is the defects in budgeting and estimation or controller over expenditure. Whether we are following those strictly or not. So I said in the initial stage itself, the budgetary practices are put to test in through appropriation accounts scrutiny. So this is one. Then I omitted here in this annexure G. So annexure G is not here. So annexure G, separate volume will be printed, and there the capital statement part one and part two, that we call it as a block account and balance sheet of the railway and P&L account will be a P&L account of the railway will be submitted under annexure G. So these are all the things that under annexures will be showing. P&L account of the Zonal Railway, balance sheet of the Zonal Railway, block account of the Zonal Railway. This balance sheet statement, it will be in units of rupees, and it will be signed in person by the PDA also. All other statements will be certified, but these are personally signed by the PDA. Okay, now let us see one by one the annexure A, expenditure held under objection. All of us, we knew during internal check, and we check 100% in advance, but certain item need to be kept under objections. So such expenditure, we have to keep them under objection. Why we need to maintain the objectionable items register, and why it has to be kept under objection? The main reason is that we should know that a certificate need to be given in the appropriation accounts by member finance and chairman railway board while signing these appropriation accounts, that all the expenditure included in the appropriation accounts, they have been sanctioned by competent authority. Please listen this. They have been sanctioned by competent authority, and with the exception of the items mentioned as in the annexure A. This is the certificate that has to be given. So therefore, we need to prepare annexure A wherever the expenditure which we incurred, if it is not covered by proper sanction, we have to keep them under objection. So by this, you will understand that the unsanctioned expenditure will be classified into three heads. One is want of estimate, another one is excess over estimate, and third one is miscellaneous irregularity. Any of our accounts objections or audit objections also, if any raised, and that has to be indicated here. Not only that, it will also indicate the unsanctioned expenditure. An item should classified amounting to more than 1 lakh and less than 1 lakh. Two categories we have to prepare, and these less than 1 lakh and more than 1 lakh of expenditure put under objection at the end of the year. If it is not covered by proper sanction, we need to obtain, we need to explain, we need to figure it in annexure A. And here, by bifurcating this, we also need to mention number of items and expenditure up to the earlier than previous year, and expenditure during the previous year, and expenditure during the current year. This should be compared with the previous year and current year figures, and the total items and amount need to be mentioned. And by this, what is going to happen? You will be understanding that a footnote of the statistics will be given in this appropriation accounts, that how much is the total amount held under objection, that means unsanctioned, remained unsanctioned, to the total expenditure audited by CNHE. So what is the total expenditure audited, and what is the percentage of this objectionable item held under objections? Percentage will be indicated in the appropriation account annexure A. So that is normally 1%. Roughly 1 to 1.5%. So this is there any criteria? No, not like that. But we will to know that how much of our expenditure, which was admitted by the accounts in the internal check, is held under objection. So you will understand that it is around 1%. Okay. Apart from this, another statement under annexure A only, many of us we do not know. So we'll be prepared, showing that the number of works estimates of which were passed provisionally by accounts or audit, which will normally no estimate will be certifying provisionally. So therefore, such expenditure will be nil. And however, in the consolidated statement, a nil statement also will be given. Then annexure B, it is under charges. Under charges detected normally whenever audit or our accounts department finds out the under charges in the traffic accounts, railway wise in the consolidated statements, opening balance will be there and the total amount of under charge detected in the accounts, okay, excluding those withdrawn. Normally we will give credit advice note. So excluding those withdrawn, how much amount of total under charges we have detected, and then what are the total earnings audited, then again what is the percentage. So it is around 0.14 or 0.15% generally, and then the total amount of under charges will be given, total outstanding also it is given. These are annexure B, under charges detected. Then annexure C, these are remission or abandonment of claims. Sometimes we will forego certain amount. Mostly that foregoing will be in wharfage and demurrage. So these wharfage and demurrage items or other items also, if any we have foregone, again this will be just like unsanctioned expenditure, how more than 1 lakh and less than 1 lakh, how we have bifurcated. Here also amounting to 25,000 each or more and amounting to less than 25,000 and each. So these items, number of items, debits, total and total earnings audited, and then total demurrage, wharfage recovered, and outstanding demurrage and wharfage, with those details we'll be showing them, and a separate statement will be more focusing on the more than 1 lakh if any waiver is there. So such items, a separate statement will be incorporated. Then I said this is the most laborious work, that is annexure D, expenditure on open land works and new construction. So this this will give the review. It is a review of open land works and new constructions, detailing important works which were undertaken. That is most important, without budget provision. See here, you see, without budget provision. So without budget provision, if any work is there, then that will be indicated here. Not all the works. So it will be in three parts. In here, part 1A, here you works costing more than 2.5 crores or over more than 2.5 crores, which were undertaken without budget provision. Normally, these are pink book items. Without budget provision, we will not take. So therefore, normally the nil statement will be given. Then part 1B, works 2.5 crores and more of the previous year on which expenditure was booked during the current year without budget provision. So here, this is pertaining to the previous year, but in this year, we have incurred expenditure even though budget provision is not there. So if any such items are there, we will be pointing out and bring them under part 1B. Okay, now part 2. So part 1 is over. Now part 2, works costing 2.5 crores, more than 2.5 crores or more, for which budget provision existed but were not undertaken. So ULTA, if the budget provision is available but we have not incurred any expenditure, in such case we have to give reasons. So these are 2.5 crores or more, part 2. Then third part, last part of the annexure D. So this here also, variation between original estimate and expenditure in respect of works completed during the year. So whatever year to which the appropriation accounts pertain, so in during that year, costing not less than 2.5 crores. That means, again, this is a pink book item. So pink book items which were completed during the year, for them, original estimate how much and expenditure incurred how much, what is the excess or saving, and what are the reasons. So this is part 3. So duly complying with these details to the criteria, whatever I have mentioned. So this Annexure D, it will be submitted by Open Line and Construction Organizations. And this, if they give in a proper format, it will be easy for us to compile and give. Okay, so this is Annexure D. Then Annexure E is Capital and Revenue Expenditure of Strategic Lines. I already told that Northern Railway, North Central Railway, Western Railway, and Northwestern Railway, these are the railways which are having strategic lines, and all other railways which do have only commercial lines, normally they send an actual E, nil statement. Okay. Then estimated and actual credits or recoveries is already I explained. Then an actual H, this all items of losses, excepting those relating to stores and stores accounts, because normally the losses under stores accounts, normally they are booked under stock adjustment account, isn't it? So other than them, any write-off of payments or some fire takes place and some losses incurred due to accidents. So such items, if they are written off, then they should be exhibited in this annexure. So, but here also, again, less than above 50,000 crores, sorry, above 50,000 each item, and less than 50,000 each item, we have to bifurcate losses which are booked to our final heads, final abstracts. You may be aware that around minor head 900 or so, always it will have in the end the losses. So those losses, it will be summarized, and items more than 50,000 individually we will be giving, and less than 50,000 in one lump sum we will be giving. And a brief explanation we will be giving that the circumstances under which led to that particular loss, and is it due to natural calamity, a fire or earthquake, or loss due to accident. So such details will be given. Suppose the right of sanction was not yet received. So you will mention make a mention in the footnote. So this is how it will be done. And apart from this, a separate statement under actual H losses only, ex gratia payments which were made during for the passengers who lost their lives. So under sub major head 10 or abstract 12, that also will be exhibited. Then annexure I, irregular reappropriation, normally it will be nil. Okay. Then annexure J. Now coming to annexure J, due to merger of our railway budget with general budget, the number of misclassification items, they have become very less, as all demands, 16 demands have been merged into one. So therefore, the items are limited, only misclassification items are limited, only that which require regularization under Parliament Article 115 of the Constitution. Only such items. What are those such items? The difference, the which should have been booked under voted, charged, or should have been booked under voted. Then should have been booked under revenue, but booked under capital, or should have been booked under capital, but booked under revenue. So these are all the things, they will form an action change. All other mistakes normally at journal level, they will be dealt by PDA, and we need to focus on that and see that they are not repeated. So this is how it will be done. And an action B, part one review, or an action K, otherwise popularly known. So these are all the items, normally the audit will include such items. But as I said, if any item of this falling below the limits, then we can request the auditor to drop such items. Okay. Now, annexure G, that is most important. Another important annexure G, which I said that it is finance accounts. There are three statements which are included. So, what are the three statements which are included? These are, number one, profit and loss account of the railway. Number two, block account or capital statement, part one and part two. So what is there in the capital statement part one, and what will be there in the part two? Part one is only for capital, and part two, capital plus other sources. So if you want to know the assets value, then part two, if you can look at, you will get. And only on loan account, if you want, you can see at part one. Okay. Then the third one is balance sheet. So now let us see P&L account, what it contains. So this is the P&L account of the railway. So where the expenditure and earnings and suspense figures are excluded. Miscellaneous expenditure and miscellaneous receipts are taken into account. Miscellaneous expenditure, miscellaneous account, they are taken into account. And then profit or loss, it will be arrived. In the year which I have taken, it is profit that is available around 3,787 crores. Okay. So suspense figures, as I said, they are excluded. Okay. Now, then annexure G, another statement, finance statement is block account part one. So as I said, in the block account part one, only capital will be there. Normally government capital will be specific debt only. Specific debt will be very less and non-specific debt will be there. And those figures, it will be included and they will be shown on liability side as well as on the asset side, both tally. Then these figures will be, that is 3,51,000 crores. This will be again brought forward to the capital statement part two. So this is first item, it will be there on liability side as well as on the asset side, they will be there. And apart from that, what are all the funds through which the block the assets was created? That is DRF spending, development fund spending, and miscellaneous items, capital fund spending, or railway safety fund spending, RRSK spending. All those items, they will be indicated. And then finally, compared with the previous year. So this is how the block account is prepared. Then, third one is balance sheet. So this is the balance sheet of Indian Railways. So total statement, that is, as indicated in the annexure capital statement 2, block account, as it is, it will be taken. And then it will be shown on the asset side also, whatever it was shown. So asset created, and this is the liability. From DRF we are taken, or DF we are taken, capital fund we are taken, capital we are taken. So other railway funds, it will be taken. Then PF, SBF, loans given to employees on liability side. And banking accounts, which include DRF, DF, pension fund, capital fund, railway safety fund, debt service fund, RRSK, and other government funds, all these funds, they will be forming liability side, will be showing. And then similar figures will be incorporating, that is fixed assets are created as in block account, and banking contra entry. So banking entries here, whatever we have shown, so that banking entry figures, total it will be there, 61,620, same figure, contra figure it will be shown. Then the suspense figures, traffic suspense figure, demands recoverable, miscellaneous advance, cash in hand, reserve funds and investments. So such items will be there, and accounts with states also will be there, and central, PNT, government. By this you will be understanding that structure of accounts, whatever we learned, that will be available here. So, and accounts with Bangladesh and Pakistan Railways also, that will be taken, and then the total balances will be arrived, and juxtaposition will be comparing with the previous year and the current year. So this is how the annexures are prepared. Then now let us go to final segment of our seminar. It is related to appropriation accounts and statements. But before going to that, in the balance sheet, because of the IRFC lease we'll be taking. So in the IRFC lease, capital segment and revenue segment also will be there. Whatever payments we are making under 9G and 2200 leased assets will be giving. So as per the public accounts committee recommendations, we need to give a disclosure in the balance sheet. So what is the disclosure in the balance sheet which we have to incorporate? It is the value of the assets taken on lease during the year. Suppose 2020-21. So what are the value of the assets which we have taken on lease? That we have to give, that disclosure. Another disclosure which we have to give is what is the capital component of the payment which we made during the year. How much under 2200, how much we have made payment. So that we have to give. So these are all the things which we have to keep it in mind while compiling the annexures. Now let us go to appropriation accounts, statements and accounts. All of us, we already, yeah. So these are all the statements and accounts, which I said around how many? Around 15 statements will be there. So statement showing the distributable expenditure and receipts. I will explain this later. So this is distributable expenditure, then changes in forms and classification, then percentage of working expenses to earnings, otherwise known as operating ratio, comparing with that of previous year, whether it is faring well or worsening, then capital statement, a statement of credit to capital for the retired assets, which otherwise we call it as write-back adjustments, how many we have made and what is the value that we have to give, then statement of annual voted and charged expenditure, then DRF, these are the individual accounts, both debit and credit and balance we have to give, including the credit interest created by central government, that also we have to show. Normally these are compiled in board level, so they are DRF account, pension fund account, DF account, capital fund account, safety fund account, debt servicing fund account. So we, all these are funded with government, central government, so therefore we'll get credit interest also on these, so we have to get them. And statement of suspense balances, then stores account, annual statement of stores transactions, results of stock verification, revaluation and stock adjustment account. This one statement also we will be preparing, and then for preparing this statement we employ our stock verification wing. Then P&L account of the catering, railway catering units. So earlier in Annexure J we saw the P&L account of entire general railway, that is different, and here it is the P&L account of the railway catering units where railway manages. So those units, whether they are running in losses or in profit, or if in loss, then management can take a decision to close or to continue. So P&L account of catering, railway catering units, that will be. Then the new statement, that is statement of plan head-wise, including suspense heads, that is inventory heads, source-wise, voted and charged, gross credit net in units of rupees we will be giving. And this is one statement which will be in units of rupees. So these are all the things which we will be compiling as a subsidiary statement or accounts. So let us see one by one. So statement showing the distributable expenditure and receipts. Now what is meant by this distributable receipts and expenditure? The receipts, you can see, distributable expenditure pertains to Railway Board, centralized training institutes, RDSO, RRBs, miscellaneous special establishments, and CNDG office expenditure. So this is under major head 3001, it will be there, and then it is like on cost, so it is distributable to all general railways. So on pro forma basis, we will be taking them into account while preparing the balance sheet. So therefore, this will be communicated by Railway Board. So based on that, each general railway will take into account. So this is the statement of distributable expenditure and receipts. And receipts, what are the receipts which will have the receipts from RRB? Because this also it goes to miscellaneous receipt under 1001. This is 3001, okay? Then, so the distributable amount will be taking into the P&L account and other statements which we will be preparing in the MIS reports. On pro forma basis, we will be taking. So therefore, we should ensure that this relevant letter, whatever it is given, they are incorporated in our journal railway pro forma statements and MIS reports. Okay. Then the changes in forms and classification. This is Annexure A, part one of review. Annexure B, we knew. Annexure B is control over expenditure. Or Annexure K, which we otherwise call defects in budgeting. So Annexure A is part one review. All of us, we knew that any change in form and classification, it is subject to approval from C&HC. So any change that is communicated by dialogue board, it should be made, it should be effected. Once it is effected, then there is no problem. And what are the changes that were brought in? We have to bring that to the notice of the C&AG and PAC through appropriation accounts. One statement which will be doing this. So this will help us that we are whether implementing the classification changes in forms and classification, that is most important. Then changes in form, normally it is nil, and classification changes, whatever they were issued during the year, that will be indicated here. Then another statement is percentage of working expenses, operating ratio. This is Annexure C of Part 1. This each railway and railway, Indian Railway as a whole, it will be given. Comparing with the previous years. Okay. Previous 2 years it will be compared. Then another statement is statement of credit to capital to retained assets. And another one is annual voted and charged expenditure, that will be given. And then I said the subsidiary under the subsidiary statements and accounts, each DRF, DF, pension fund, capital fund, safety fund, debt servicing fund, these accounts, each one we have to give. So so here you can see year opening balance, appropriation to the fund, that is under through abstract M. So how much it was appropriated and interest created by Government of India, and then expenditure, what we met from this fund, that is incurred during the year, then net accretion, that means appropriation and expenditure. So net accretion and then closing balance, that means opening balance plus expenditure incurred, and that closing balance, how much it is available. Finally, for each under DRF, how much it is available, this information, it will be shown in thousands of rupees. And this is the DRF statement which I have shown, for example, and similar way statements will be prepared for all other funds also. Then statement for suspense balances will be shown, that is balances at the end of the current year, debit and credit both, it will be shown, and relating to the previous year, relating to the previous year, third year also it will be shown, and relating to the prior to previous year also it will be shown, so that a comparison can be made for the suspense heads. What are the suspense heads which we will be giving? They are miscellaneous advances revenue, miscellaneous advances capital, and the purchases. So these are the MTP. So these are the statements, suspense heads, which will be incorporated under the statement of balances under suspense accounts. Then stores account, statement of stores account. So in this stores account, the statement of stores account will give the opening balance, it will give, and then receipts, it will be there, and issues during the year, and closing balance, it will be there. But these will be under classification, each classification classified as ordinary stores, stores for a special works, surplus, movable surplus, and debt surplus, scrap. So this is how the classification wise it will be given. Okay, then the closing balance, total put together also, it will be given. So this is the stores account, which is compiled as a part of appropriation accounts. Then results of stock verification and revaluation. All of us, we knew a wing was is established stock verification wing. So the results of stock verification will be given, and here also it will be like opening balance, how much opening balance, and what is the surplus or deficiency, and then net surplus or deficiency, amount adjusted, and the closing balance, and what is the percentage of this closing stock verification results to the net surplus, net deficiency, or excess during to the total issues during the year. So the percentage, so that it will indicate the effectiveness or efficiency of the stock verification session. So what is the percentage of the deficiencies to the total issues during the year? So this is the results of stock verification. Then revaluation. All of us, we knew that in stores code para 210, it shows mandates that the revaluation of the stock should be made if the fall is the, or increase is there more than 10%. So such results of the stock revaluation, it will be done. So that will be indicated here. Then other miscellaneous items, that is due to evaporation or some losses, some other losses, if any are there. So those surpluses or savings, it will be indicated under miscellaneous. So this is results of stock verification and revaluation. Next, P&L account of the catering units. So on the debit side, we'll be having the opening stock, expenditure related to the catering unit will be shown. So how much it is there, then on the credit side, by way of sales, how much you got, and sales tax, how much you earned, and sundry other receipts, how much you got, and then by closing stock, how much you are having, and is it by loss or the balancing it will be done. So the unit, the year for which I have taken, and as an example, there is a loss of 47 lakhs. And in 2018-19, it was 23 lakhs. So this is how the profit and loss account of the railway catering units, it will be given. So this is how the appropriation accounts of subsidiary statements and accounts, the third part also concluded. Now let us see that the appropriation accounts, target dates, whatever, as I mentioned in the railway board letter, whatever they are there, we have to adhere to. Okay. Then all observations on appropriation must be promptly give replied at unit level, at the divisional level or journal level, it should be replied within 1 week. Then any correction slips, they should be promptly sent. Then audit shall wait, normally 2 weeks time is given in the schedule itself. And if for our observation, for our reply, if any rebuttal is there, it should be given at PDA level, and that will be communicated to PFA within 3 calendar days of receipt of our reply. And the reply for the rebuttal also at journal level, it should be given at 2 calendar days. So this schedule we have to necessarily follow. Then when we submit all our statements, then Railway Board consolidated appropriation accounts, they will submit it to Deputy CNDJ or DAI, we call them, and it presented to Public Accounts Committee. Consolidated appropriation accounts are accompanied by a statement bringing out the financial results, compared to the budget estimates and revised estimates. Then after audit certifies, appropriation accounts are printed, and printed copies are sent to CNDJ, and they will be tabled before Parliament. So certified appropriation accounts consists of part one, review. So this is what we saw, part one, annexures A, B, C, like that. Then part two, detailed appropriation accounts. And part two, again, detailed appropriation accounts only. Here, annexure G will be there separately. All other annexures and statements will be there under part one as well as part two. Okay. So the Public Accounts Committee, it examines, and audited appropriation makes recommendations. Makes recommendations means any excess is there, it will be regularized, it should be regularized, they make recommendation, and PAC also will examine, and then these whatever observations of the PAC on appropriation accounts, other things are there, they are recommendatory in nature, they are placed before Parliament in the winter session of the account to which they pertain. So 2020-21 means 21 winter session they will be prepared. So that is why within those 2 months, say from May or June to September, so before that the appropriation accounts need to be completed. So, and again, wherever action taken note need to be taken, and after placing before Parliament, we will be giving action taken note in the next year accounts come for examination. Before that, we'll be giving that. So, thank you very much. I will close at this point of time, and any doubt or any clarification that you require, you may ask.
Yeah, participants, all are unmuted. You please ask
sir, please one second.
One incorporate law book.
One by one you can ask.
Sir,
Tell me.
Finance accounts, sir. Yes, sir. One second, define, sir.
Finance accounts, see. Finance accounts,
I have one question.
Yeah. One sec. Finance accounts, which as a part of our annual.
Sir, please unmute, sir. Sir, Damodar, sir.
Please listen, see, finance accounts as a part of annual accounts, whatever we compile, they are in tune with government accounting system. They are different. And as a part of our appropriation accounts, finance accounts, they were separately defined. They are annexure G. Under annexure G, there are three statements which we prepare. So these three statements, that is capital statement, part one and part two, that is block account, P&L account of the Zonal Railway, and balance sheet of the Zonal Railway, these are related to the commercial aspects of our railway working system. But in appropriation accounts, they are termed as finance accounts under annexure G.
Participants, please raise your hand in the reaction column so that I will unmute. Sharma, please speak.
Sharma ji, yeah, tell me. Yes, sir.
Sir.
Yeah, please.
Sir.
Yes.
Sir, this year we railway used the EBR, sir, extra budgetary resources, in place of capital and RRSK, sir. So it is required to prepare the appropriation account for EBRS, sir.
No. Because the name itself indicates that EBR, it is extra budgetary resource. So that means even while submitting our requirements also, EBR, in the pink book, EBR will be there separately. So, and wherever, whatever our railway amount is there, that only we will put for vote of Parliament. We will not take EBR amount into our account, because whatever EBR amount it is coming, it is outside the budget purview. So we need not prepare.
It is there in the PB and LB, sir. And
what
expenditure we have paid in the capital RSK, this has been transferred to EBR.
Then in that case, so once you book to EBR as a part of railway board instructions, you need to incorporate in our appropriation accounts.
More question is there, sir. Sir, whether any changes has been made in the appropriation account after merger of budget, sir?
In appropriation accounts?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, that's what I told. Previously, we used to have 16 demands, sir. For each demand, excess over estimate, excess of the grant or saving in the grant, we used to explain, and standing committees, they used to come under scathing attack on railway. because for managing 16 demands, it is very difficult. But now, with the merger of railway budget, only one demand, that is 84 or 82 or 83, whatever it may be. So, one demand. So, under that, what is the capital? So, under major head, each major head, 3002, 3003, like that. And then, capital segment, 5002, 5003. And under that also, again, capital and plan head. And other sources, plan head. So, whatever expenditures, they do, totally, in the end, what is the total grant of all these and what is the total expenditure on these? Whether excess is there or less is there. Generally, what I observed is, for the past 2 to 3 years, we are on saving side. So, excess for excess or expenditure, for not controlling that, we are not coming under the attack from parliamentary committee or even from audit also. That is the advantage which we have. And this is the major change. That is one. And another change that has been brought in is because the demands are not there, the grants are merged. So, therefore, under one grant, our reappropriations, they have become very easy. And thereby, our mistakes in class, mistakes or misclassification, what we call it as from one grant to another grant. So, one grant to another grant is not there. So, therefore, the misclassifications have come down drastically. Now, the misclassification, it has been only on account of voted to charged or charged to voted, or revenue to capital or capital to revenue.
Yeah, Mr. Santosh Kumar, please ask.
Mr. Santosh, you can ask question.
Yeah, Mr. Prashant, please go ahead.
In the NXLP, that's actually compared to statistics line.
NXLC.
NXLP, sir, the capital and revenue expenditure of strategic lines, sir.
Okay. It is the expenditure. I said that only four railways, they have got this separate account, because in government accounting, commercial and other than that is strategic lines, separately we have to give. It is a basic function of our government accounting system, apart from capital and revenue. We have to bifurcate our expenditure, strategic lines and commercial lines. The strategic lines are the lines which are constructed for defense purposes, strategic purposes.
Right.
So therefore, their expenditure and their earnings have to be separately captured. So, Northern Railway, Northwestern Railway, Western Railway, these are the railways, they do have these strategic lines. So, they will...
The defense purposes.
Yeah, only for those lines, those railways which have strategic lines, they will be bifurcating and they will be classifying their expenditure not under, say, for example, our revenue expenditure is there. We will be bifurcating the, we will be incorporating under 3002 major head, but they will incorporate under 3003 only for the portion of the strategic line. Similarly, receipts are there. Suppose our commercial lines, our receipts, normally we will be under 1002 major head, but they will incorporate under 1003. Similarly, capital expenditure, we will be incorporating under major head 5002, but they will be incorporating under 5003 portion of capital expenditure, which they incurred on the strategic line. So, wherever strategic, only for those four railways which do have the strategic lines, they will be compiling separately. Normally, all other railways, an actual E statement, they will be sending only nil statement will be sending, and then audit will certify like that.
Right. Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Hello, sir.
Yes, please.
Sir, an actual J and H defines the preparation of.
Yeah, annexure J and
H.
Okay. Annexure H is losses. Normally, we knew that some accident take place. Our loco will get damaged, or coaches will get damaged, or our wagons will get damaged, or some fire accident may take place in a particular railway, or some theft may take place. So all those will be termed as losses. So losses, you will be obtaining sanction of competent authority, and based on that, that will be booked to revenue abstract. So after booking revenue abstract, at the end of the year, in the appropriation accounts. When we are given concurrence, there will be a... Or even other things also, you can obtain from the department concerned what are the laws which were booked, we knew from our account current. So, those details you will be obtaining, a brief narration you will be giving, and then you will be giving under appropriate causes due to accident, due to fire, due to other reasons, miscellaneous reasons, or due to theft. Like this, you will be bifurcating them and then showing them. These are, and again, you will be bifurcating them more than 50,000 and less than 50,000. So less than 50,000, one lump sum you can give, and more than 50,000 individually, you will give what is the head that is operated, and what are the laws and what are the reasons. So this is annexure H. Okay, now come to the annexure J. Annexure J, I said that these are misclassification and mistake. Now mistakes are dealt at journal level, and misclassification is now because of the merger of our railway budget with general budget, and because only one grant is allotted to railway, now we are saved. Because previously we used to have 16 demands. So under the 16 demands, from one grant to another grant, if some mistake is there, then it used to be treated as a misclassification. But now only one grant. So now whatever we are having, only sub-major heads. So therefore, it has been defined now misclassification. What is defined as a misclassification now in the present circumstances is that any mistake you make from classifying a particular expenditure, revenue to capital, or capital to revenue, then it is a misclassification. Say, for example, all of us, we knew that those who are working in our establishment sections, they have this problem where details are not forthcoming, or which the expenditure of work charge posts, which are chargeable to capital, normally they are booked to revenue, and they will remain in revenue. And at the end of the year, audit will be viewing this, and then they will be asking us to incorporate that amount which is not transferred to capital to in the appropriation account under annexure A. And we do not have any of defense to prove or to disprove our guilty, because there is sanction. And it does the amount has to be transferred to other than transferred to capital, but we have not transferred. So therefore, we are helpless, and we have to meet it, accept that yes, it is a mistake. So we will be accepting, and then it will be finding place in annexure J item. So then, and one more important point is that it is now limited only to this another segment, and it is voted and charged. Normally, there should not be such a mistake happening. But sometimes it happens. So in such case also, that is, if it is voted, and you can book to voted expenditure, and if it is only by decree of court of law, that is most important. That amount only should go to charged expenditure. Otherwise, it is voted expenditure only. Normally, we should not make any mistake, but I saw in appropriation accounts, still some railways are making such a mistake also.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, please.
Sir, my question is, how to write the answer for appropriation accounts in Appendix 3A exam? Do we have to mention accounts code, form numbers, or draw the table, or we can write the summary of the appropriation account?
Yeah, a very good question from our examination point of view. That is why I made it actually two sessions I should have taken, but I made it that you should have a comprehensive idea of whole of the appropriation accounts. Yeah, so my presentation is whole of the appropriation accounts, right? Starting from my annual accounts to finance accounts code, our finance code also, where appropriation accounts in detail they were dealt. So the appropriation accounts, what we are preparing, it is part of our annual accounts. But as detailed in finance code, we have to prepare. And as far as 3A examination is concerned, normally you restrict your answer, even though I have given elaborately, you restrict your answer only to the points what the question they have given. Normally, say for example, they'll give like this: what is the importance of appropriation accounts? In what form, how the explanations will be explained? How the variations will be explained? What are the annexures that accompany the appropriation accounts? So in such case, suppose depending upon the marks allotted, 10 plus 5, 5 plus 10 plus 5, like that they'll give. Okay, accordingly, you do that. Okay, then suppose they ask some state, write about two annexures, if they ask. So whatever annexure which you are conversant, now I am confident that I can write, say, unsanctioned expenditure. Annexure J, you write. Annexure J, I am confident. So you write annexure J. Otherwise, for each of the annexure, you please mention one or two lines about that. So this is how we should, and especially statements and accounts also, you please make a mention. That is why I gave with examples also. Please go through my entire session. You sit for 2 hours or 3 hours. Even though I have completed within 1.5 hour, for you, it may take some 2 to 3 hours because beside you, you keep your finance code and accounts code chapter 7 also, where first para you read and then go to finance code. Keep finance code and go through my presentation. And I am confident that after listening to my lesson, you will be in a position to write whatever way the question comes, you will be in a position to answer. Any other questions, Nayasura Garu?
Parchments?
So should we close?
Yeah, please, Manish Varman.
Yes, sir. I have already asked the question.
Okay, right.
Thank you. Dear participants, thank you once again.
I have a question, sir.
Yes, please.
Sir, I want to ask, after the merger of the railway budget, what will come under the annexure I, which reappropriation?
Normally, the reappropriation, there are certain, every 2015, Railway Board has given reappropriation instructions. And the reappropriation between grants is not there. The reappropriation between the sources, yes, it is a irregular reappropriation. Same source, different plan heads, absolutely no issue. And moreover, when we, all these reappropriations, they come for our accounts concurrence. In budget section, we will be dealing. And there, we will be scrutinizing those with reference to the Railway Board letters, whatever permissible reappropriations are not permissible reappropriations. With our concurrence only, they will be making. So therefore, all our irregular reappropriations will be nil. The two statements, why two? Three statements I will be sending nil. One is annexure I, annexure J, and annexure K. Later on, the audit will point out mistakes. But as far as annexure I is concerned, 100% we will not do any mistake. Because all that it will be, whatever, suppose from priority work, we should not take out money. Definitely we will not take out. Suppose the amount, whatever we have reappropriated, 100% amount, we should not reappropriate. So 1 lakh should be there. So 1 lakh we'll keep, and then for the remaining amount only, we'll be giving concurrent.
Sir, no audio, sir. Please.
So from 27, 28, and 32, in between we can reappropriate. So any reappropriation comes, Yes, we will be concurring and then we will be making change in the budget VPN. So there should not be any mistake. So that is why always irregular reappropriation will be nil. But one important point is that whenever we are doing the reappropriations, for the same work, for they should not ask more in the where in the successive reviews. So that we have to be very, very careful. And one more point of irregular reappropriation, normally audit will point out, is that we took the reappropriation and the work where we have taken money, they didn't spend. Definitely they will point out it as a irregular reappropriation. Similarly, the work from which we have taken the money, but later on executive asked money and we have allowed it, then in that case, audit will point out that it is a irregular reappropriation. Because we knew that there is no need for money, so we have taken out. So, but when we are asking more, then it is a irregular reappropriation, audit will point out. Similarly, where we have taken money because we are seeing the progress of the work, and then we thought that the work will go up, amount is required, so therefore we have given. But suppose it is not being utilized, then in that case, it is a irregular reappropriation. So the irregular reappropriation, in two ways we have to see. So where the money to be utilized, not utilized, it is a irregular reappropriation. And the reappropriation which is done in not in accordance with the rule provided, that is Railway Board letters, if we do, then that also constitute irregular reappropriation.
End of the main question, sir. And we are not up to the standard of some concepts in some areas, sir. So how we can manage to write the tag questions in a proper way, and maybe presentation also, we are a little bit poor, sir. So this is my opinion. So how do we both have to manage how to write the written skill in examination point of view, sir?
So one important point is, what is the question given? Always keep your focus on the question. Suppose, what is the importance of appropriation accounts? So you have to write that parliamentary control. You have to write about the excess grant regularization. And it is a constitutional function that we have to report back to parliament comparing. So these things you have to mention. So that will be around 5 months. Then later on, suppose they say how the many people they will be writing not asked, but what they knew. So there the problem comes. So suppose they ask in the examination, they asked how the explanations are explained, how the variations are explained. So some 7 to 5 paras are there in the finance code, which I have summarized in my presentation also. You have to make a mention them. Now, don't go because we knew annexures or we knew about statements. Don't go to that. So, how the variation should be explained in appropriation accounts. So, I said that workshop from which you have to get the debit, you have to write there. Why you didn't get. And why you are not postponed, that also you have to write. And at one place you have to give reason, if it is repeating, you need not write. So there are certain guidelines were given. So accordingly you have to see. And while giving the explanation also, the primary unit wise statement, if you have from computer center, it will be easy for you to compile the answer. So this is how the explanation should be given. So next, suppose they say, what are the annexures that are compiled as a part of appropriation accounts. So you have to make a mention of annexure, all these annexures, A2K. And you have to explain them, not just writing. And two, three lines you have to explain. Suppose any four or two appropriation accounts, annexures, you please explain. Then in that case, whatever narration I have given, you please explain. Similarly, what are the statements and accounts that are accompanying the appropriation accounts? That also you have to make a mention. Then finally, how they are prepared, what are the time limits, and who will sign, and what is the purpose of these public accounts scrutiny? So that also you have to make a mention. So depending upon the question, you, because entire my presentation, it will, it has been covered on the appropriation accounts. No, nothing is left out. So depending upon your question, you mold your answer. Always prepare your own notes. Then it will be easy for you to write and score good marks. So another my important submission is that don't write what you knew. Write in accordance with, you mold, you change your answer in such a way that it suits to the answer that was given, the question that was given. Then you will score